Hi, this is Jennifer Waymark, archivist, and you're listening to an Oshawa Museum podcast. This podcast series aims to actively promote awareness and appreciation of our community's history, highlighting remarkable artifacts, documents, photographs, or events from our past. We hope you enjoy the podcast. Today, we are returning to my research into early Black history in the area and looking farther back than we have before. John Baker is an important part of Oshawa's history, even though it is entirely possible he never spent any time here. Baker was one of three slaves granted freedom from slavery, along with land and money, in the will of their master, Robert Isaac Dey Gray, Solicitor-General of Upper Canada. His connection to Gray, along with being named in the will, resulted in Baker gaining a level of fame and notoriety. A quick search on the internet turns up a surprising amount of information on the man and his life. In a publication on the early history of the town of Cornwall, Ontario, author Jacob Ferrand Pringle wrote about Baker and provided information about the life of the man thought to be the last surviving enslaved person of African descent in both Canada East and Canada West. The Baker family can be traced back to a gentleman by the name of Cato Prime. Prime was a native of Guinea, West Africa, before being sold into slavery to John Lowe of New Jersey. Prime had a daughter named Levine, who in turn had a daughter named Durin, all of whom were slaves to the Lowe family. Durin was given as a gift to Elizabeth Lowe, the daughter of John, and came with Elizabeth when she married Captain John Gray. According to Pringle, Durin was 17 years old when the Gray family brought her to Canada with them. The Greys resided in Montreal from 1776 to 1784 when they moved to an area just east of Cornwall, Upper Canada. Durin met and married Jacob Baker in Grays Creek, the area just east of Cornwall named for the Gray family. Baker's history is unclear. In an interview with the Toronto newspaper in 1869, John says that his family was a Dutchman. However, in his book on the history of Osgoode Hall, author James Hamilton states that Baker was a German Hussein who served with the British Army during the American Revolution. Either way, Baker was a free man while Durin remained a slave to the Gray family. According to Pringle, the Bakers had a large family. The two eldest children, Simon and John, were born slaves, as the law at the time stated that the children inherited the status of their mother. Two daughters, Elizabeth and Bridget, were born free, as laws had changed prior to their birth. Upon the death of John Gray, Durin and her sons became the property of Robert Isaac Dey Gray, the son of Elizabeth and John. In his interview with the Toronto newspaper, Baker recounts his life with the Gray family. Referring to John Gray as Colonel, Baker spoke of how strict his master was. Quote, "The Colonel had much property. He was strict and sharp, made us wear deerskin shirts and deerskin jackets, and gave us many a flogging. At these times he would pull off my jacket and the raw hide would fly around my shoulders very fast." End quote. Robert Isaac Dey Gray was apparently less cruel to those he owned. After practicing law in Cornwall for a short time, he went to York and in 1787 was named the first Solicitor General of Upper Canada. Gray took Simon Baker with him to act as his body servant. In August 1798, Elizabeth Gray was granted 600 acres of property in Whitby Township. It is this property that connects the Baker brothers and Gray to Oshawa. Robert Isaac Dey Gray and Simon Baker died when the ship they were traveling on, the Speedy, wrecked near Presqu'île, Brighton on October 7, 1804. In his will, Gray not only granted freedom to Durin and her family, he also made provisions for her future. The will stipulates that £1,200 from his real estate holdings be put into a fund for Durin, and that the interest be given to her annually. He also left provisions in his will for Simon and John. To Simon, he left 200 acres of Lot 11 in the second concession, as well as his clothes and watch worth £50. To John, he left 200 acres of Lot 17 in the first concession, along with £50. Land registry documents show that the property left to John was finally transferred to him on June 12, 1824. John did not keep the property, as records indicate the lot was sold to Martin Sanford on June 14, 1824. The records are difficult to read, and it is unclear how much money John sold the lot for. Baker's interview with the newspaper gives us a glimpse into his life as a free man. After Gray's death released Baker from slavery, he began to work for Justice William Dummer Powell. While with Powell, he enlisted with the army and went to New Brunswick and fought in the War of 1812. According to Baker, he was with his regiment at Lundy's Lane, Fort Erie, and at Sackett's Harbor during battles there. It appears that Baker was in the military until after the Battle of Waterloo, where he apparently saw Napoleon and was not particularly impressed. From his interview with the newspaper, quote, "I saw Napoleon. He was a chunky little fella. He rode hard and jumped ditches," end quote. Once his time in the military ended, Baker returned to Canada and settled back in Cornwall. He worked in the area until age caught up with him. Around 1861, he received a pension from the British government for his time in the military. John Baker died on January 18, 1871. At the time of his death, Baker was believed to be the last person to have been held in slavery in the Canadas. Many Canadians do not know that slavery existed here. Baker's life helps us to better understand slavery in the Canadian context. This has been an Oshawa Museum podcast. Thank you for listening. If you enjoyed this video, be sure to check out our other historical video podcasts and subscribe to our channel.